I did something truly amazing this morning. And maybe you did as well. I drank a glass of water. Okay, not the reaction I was hoping for, but it is truly amazing. It's not that obvious that that water gets into your tap. Because if you think of it, 97% of all water on Earth is salt water. We can't drink that. And even the 3% fresh water is not that readily available to us. I'm going to show you. Imagine that the 3% of fresh water is captured in this bottle over here. It's 1 liter of water. All the fresh water on Earth. Now, 80% of that I can just as easily throw away. So I'm going to pour that away. Keep going. There we are. That's water that is captured in ice caps, in glaciers. We can't get to that. But even this water is not that easily to reach. It's captured, a lot of it is captured in the jungle, where nobody lives. It's in groundwater underneath the Sahara, in places where we can't get. So we can throw a lot of that away as well. And this is it. This is what we have on Earth for everyone. And not only humans, but all animals as well. And then that raises the question, is this enough? Well, that depends on where you live. They make calculations about that for providing the water stress, the amount of water that's available per person in a country. And they make maps out of it, like this one. And then, for example, you have Saudi Arabia over there in dark red. And that makes sense, because it's a desert, there's no water over there. And we have Mexico, lighter red, but still a dry country. But hey, let's look at Western Europe. I will put a circle around it. Here, that's Belgium. If you rank countries with water stress from 1 to all the way at the end, Belgium is at the 22nd spot. We are between Mexico and Morocco. We have less water available than Ethiopia. That's strange. We are Belgium, the country of umbrellas and rain. Why do we have water problems? Well, there are a couple of reasons. The first reason is we have a lot of concrete in Belgium. 16% of all the surface in Belgium is concrete. And a water drop that falls down, falls on a rooftop or a parking lot, flows to the sewers, and it's gone. We are very bad at keeping our water with us. Secondly, we are with a lot of people on a small surface. So the water that is available is used by a lot of people. And the third reason is that we are very dependent on rain for our water supplies. So big rivers like the River Meuse, they don't have glaciers, they don't have the Alps, they rely on rainwater. And if the rain stops falling, we run into troubles. Now that are our problems. That means that there are solutions as well. So let's look at the first one. Less concrete in Belgium. We try to pass laws to make us build less, to take less open space, but it doesn't work that well. And even so, they talk about not building more. They're not talking about building or breaking things down. Yeah? So our solution won't come from that. Then move to the second one, the amount of people in Belgium. Let's not go there. You need a war or a pandemic to get the amount of people down. So no solution. We don't talk about that. Let's look at rain then. Can we do anything about the rain? No, it's a natural phenomenon. We can't control the rain. But it's important to know what the rain will do in the near future. And I was wondering myself. So I asked the Royal Meteorological Institute, and they sent me this image. And actually, they didn't send me this image, they sent me the climate report 2020. And I saw at the background of that cover, I saw lines. And I thought, oh, okay, well done, marketing department, nice design. Now let's read the climate report. But then, on the second page of that climate report, I saw that those lines meant something. Going from 1833 to 2019, this shows the temperature. blue for relative cold years, red for relative warm years. I'm going to repeat that. Blue for relative cold years, red for relative warm years. And then I was a little bit shocked. And you might be thinking, okay, Toon, why were you shocked? This is climate change. Have you heard about it? Yes, I did, but seeing it like this, it had an impact. And by then, I also knew what the impact on our water supplies would be. Because two things start happening when it gets warmer. The first thing that happens is that warm air can hold more water vapor, which means that water gets up into the air, stays longer over there, getting a dry period. And then when it falls, it all falls down in one go, in one big water bomb. And that's what we saw happening this summer in Wallonia. Now, next to that, warm air can hold more water vapor. A second thing is happening. The jet stream will diminish. Now, the jet stream is like the straalstroom in Dutch. It's a ferocious wind 10 kilometers above our head going at 200 kilometers an hour, and it pushes low-pressure areas and high-pressure areas around, changing our weather. Now, because the temperature difference between the poles and the equator is diminishing, the driving force of the jet stream is diminishing as well. And the jet stream starts swaying, and it can't push those pressure areas around that easily anymore. Meaning that the same weather stays at the same spot for longer periods of time. And those two effects, warm air that can hold more water vapor and weather that stays at the same spot for a longer time, gives extreme weather patterns. And we see that already. 2018, 19, 20, very dry. 2021, very wet. And that is what's happening right now with this. Yeah. All right. Here you were, thinking, this is going to be an entertaining and fun lecture, and I'm here with depressing graphs. But it doesn't have to be depressing, yeah? Because this points to our solution. The solution is that we need to manage this better. We need to manage our rain. And there are two things we can do. The first thing is, if it rains, we need to keep our water with us. Now, that's counterintuitive, isn't it? If it rains, I want my water away as quickly as possible. And that's true. I want our water away from the city centers. And in Belgium, we're masters in doing that. We have straightened our rivers. We have a good sewer system. We get away our water as quickly as possible. But if one of those water bombs fall, then our river starts flooding and the sewers start overflowing. And it happens. For example, this is Antwerp, 2018. That's the River Scheldt. In case you are wondering, you are here. Yeah, this is the Arenberg Schouwburg. We see the tidal gates just coping with the flood. Now, the reason why I just keep on coping with the flood is because 10 kilometers before this picture was taken, this was happening. There was a major nature reserve flooding with water, capturing enormous amount of water for us. And that's what we need more. We need more places where water can flow into and capture water for us. On the upside, you also get nice nature reserves where you can walk, and the water gets time to trickle into the soil, and it will be there in the groundwater supplies when we need it. So if it rains, we need to keep our water with us. Now, if it doesn't rain, we need to reuse our water. And now you might be thinking, okay, we already do that. Look, this is a wastewater treatment plant. Dirty water goes in, clean water goes out, problem solved. That's not true. The water over there is cleaned, but then it's dumped in the river, and it's gone. The average recycle amount of water in Belgium is up and about around, more or less, almost 0%. Yeah? We don't do that. And it's not that we can't do it. Yeah? For example, in the ISS, the International Space Station, they recycle their water. They take urine and breath and sweat from astronauts, they recycle it to get water again. But they have a very good incentive to do that. It takes 1,600 euros to get 1 liter of water up into the air. So they better be managing their water well over there. So their incentive is money. Their incentive to recycle water is money. Our incentive should be drought. And to explain that, I want you to take you to a very specific place in Belgium, to the Belgian coast. And specifically to the western part of the Belgian coast, the Panne, Kokseide, Nieuwpoort. They have water challenges over there. They don't have a lot of groundwater. They don't have a lot of surface water. and they need to provide water to 62,000 people in their area. But what happens in summer, when it's dry and there is no water, then they get flooded with tourists, yeah? And they all start using water. So they have a big water problem over there during summer. And they started thinking, and they thought, we need to change this. And they looked at the wastewater treatment plant close by, and they thought, why not use that water? And they were trying some things, and they thought, we will take that wastewater, clean it, and then dump it into the nature reserve. Okay, yeah. But it's a good idea, because over here I'm at the Hoge Blekker, the highest dune in Belgium. If you stand there, you can see the two infiltration ponds. Water trickles into the ground over there. But because they do it over there, the groundwater levels in the entire western corner of the coast have risen 4 to 5 meters. There's nature that we haven't seen there for the past 50 years that's returning. And 2 to 24 months after the water has trickled in, they pump it up again, clean it, and then put it into your tap. So that's wonderful. If you're ever at the coast again, the Panakokse, the Nieuwpoort, if you open your tap over there, the water flows out, goes through the sink to the wastewater treatment plant, into the dunes, they pump it up again and put it in your tap. That's wonderful, like a closed water circle. So those are our solutions. If it rains, we need to keep our water with us. If it doesn't rain, we need to reuse our water. And we will need to do that because the pattern is clear and it won't be obvious. We need to renovate a lot of sewers. We need to find places where water can flood into. We need new technology. We need companies that work together to reuse water. Now, at the end of all that, you might be wondering, okay, but what can I do? Well, if you type in how to save water on a search engine, you will find tons of options. Yeah? Don't water your garden, install a rain barrel. But there's one thing that they don't mention that matters most of all, and that is to be amazed about water again. It's not that obvious that that water gets into your tap 24/7. Thousands of people are working on that every day. So the next time you open a tap, or you take a glass of water, be amazed about the water in your glass. Thank you.